as I was you know, researching and preparing and learning about Zaynab Bint Ali in preparation, you know, for, you know, this presentation, I learned that she created gender-specific settings in which women could learn. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi al-kareem wa ba'd. Thank you for joining us again. We're still exploring the Ahli Bayti Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the family of the Prophet alayhi wa sallam. And we've taken a jump. We're taking a generational leap, right? Well, I don't even know what order you're going to post these in, so we may not be taking a generational leap. But I'm taking a generational leap, and we're looking at Zaynab Bint Ali, right? The third child of Ali and Fatima, radiallahu anhuma. And she is known as the heroine of Karbala, as the hero of Karbala. She was named by the Prophet alayhi wasallam. Something that some people might find interesting, Sayyidina Ali actually had three daughters named Zaynab, right? So she is sometimes referred to in the sources as Zaynab the eldest or Zaynab the elder, right? It's said that at Karbala, and this is, you know, subhanAllah, you know, sometimes we don't talk about Nusayba enough. We don't talk about, you know, we actually have a tradition, radiallahu anha, of women that were warriors, right? Yes, some women would perform the jihad of staying home and taking care of their households. And that, there is nothing that, in my book, parallels or rivals that struggle. But some women, because of their, I guess, unique aptitude or unique inclination for it, they actually went out and engaged as warriors. And they displayed that kind of bravery. Zaynab bint Ali, radiallahu anha, is known as the heroine of Karbala, not because she fought, but when Zain al-Abidin was sentenced to death, she threw her body over her nephew and she said, "You must kill me if you want to kill him. If you want to kill him, you must kill me." And she was ready to sacrifice her life. And this is what earned her the title, the heroine of Karbala. And this is what literally saved the life of Zain al-Abidin. Like many of the members of the household of the Prophet ﷺ, you know, she married her cousin, Abdullah ibn Ja'far, and they were very wealthy, actually. Abdullah ibn Ja'far was very wealthy, but they were known for zuhud. And you see this theme again and again coming up in the lives of the people of the family of the Prophet ﷺ. And it's an interesting parallel. You know, we're not actually, shara'an, you know, by the dictates of Islamic law, we're not actually allowed to give zakat to members of the Prophet ﷺ's family, which shows that there is no nepotism in this message. There is no preferential treatment. There's love, there's esteem, and there's looking at the family of the Prophet ﷺ as our rightful exemplars. But there is not this, you know, my family gets to collect and keep money because they're my family, and none of that occurred, right? So she was very wealthy, but she was known for zuhud. She was known for charity. She's also identified with the tradition of pious defiance, right? The Prophet ﷺ said, "Afdalu jihadin kalimatu haqqin 'inda sultanin ja'ir." So when, after Karbala, she was brought into the court of Yazid, you know, her defiance was visible. And in one report, Yazid said, "Who is this arrogant woman? Who is this?" And she said, "I am Zaynab bint Ali, the daughter of Ali and Fatima and the granddaughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." And even as she made her way back to Iraq, she would stop and she would speak her mind freely, and she was unafraid of anything or anyone. And this is why there's so much debate surrounding the occasion of her passing. Some people say she passed away in Damascus. And this is why you have a masjid in Damascus, Masjid Sayyida Zaynab. Some people say she was assassinated en route to Cairo. And this is why you have the masjid Sayyida Zaynab in Cairo. Because she moved very freely. And even though she was in a position where people would say, you know, you should just be still and, you know, there's some political tension, she moved very freely and she was unafraid. As I was, researching and preparing and learning about Zaynab Bint Ali in preparation, for this presentation, I learned that she created gender-specific settings in which women could learn. And I think that this is important. I think two things, right? It's good for, and mashallah, I know with Miftaah, you have Sheikh Zaynab bin Saadi comes in and teaches. It's good for all of us to be able to benefit from each other. So classes where you have, a male teacher and you have brothers and sisters learning, that's great. Or a woman teacher and brothers and sisters are learning, that's good. But there is still something special about women learning from other women, men learning from other men. And so this tradition that is related to Zaynab bint Ali, that she created specific settings in which women could learn their deen, I think that's very important. I think that's worth emulating. The Prophet ﷺ said, blessed are the women of the Ansar, because they did not allow ihtisham to prevent them from learning their religion. They didn't allow excessive shyness to prevent them from learning. Now, one of the things that research actually shows is that sometimes, citing research, in co-ed learning environments in which you have men and you have women, sometimes the shyness of women will, and sometimes just them reacting to just how aggressive the men can be in the learning setting, the shyness of women will prevent them from really asking their questions and getting down to what they really want to know. And they say that dissipates, that leaves when you have women studying with other women with a teacher that's a woman, right? It creates, sometimes certain things can be discussed much more easily, right? Now, it was a virtue of the women of the Ansar, radiallahu anhunna jama'a, that they didn't allow that to prevent them from learning their deen. But I think the women of the Ansar, that they didn't allow that kind of ihtisham or excessive shyness to prevent them from learning, their deen. But I think we also have to account for situations that are different. Maybe some sisters that would learn better in, gender-specific environments. And to know that was something that was recognized and acknowledged by the granddaughter of the Prophet ﷺ, places women that want to do that work of creating spaces for women to learn on very firm footing, and that they know they're following the precedent of a very strong, very brave, very outspoken woman. So jazakum Allahu kulla khayr, wa salamu alaykum. We look forward to you joining us for our next installment, inshallah.